Hi, welcome back. I'm Bob Stern. I'm a senior metrologist at Agilent Technologies, and I'm excited to bring you this module, number 6, on accreditation. The reason why I'm excited is that accreditation causes all sorts of confusion with many of our customers, and it really doesn't have to. The most obvious question is, what is accreditation? Well, it's a formal audit. By who? Well, by a representative of an accreditation body, and they're trained to assess conformance of a calibration lab to standards that matter. Now, we talked about most of these in Module 5, so the standard that is always included in an accreditation is 17025, and you can see just from the title why that would be the case. It's the competence of testing and calibration laboratories, and as I've mentioned before, part of 17025 is how do you use the ISO-GUM for your measurement uncertainty, and also are you observing the guidelines on assessment reporting via G8. Now, if a lab chooses to, they can also be accredited to Z540-1, or for that matter, the newer replacement, Z540.3. If a lab is accredited to 17025 or to one of the other standards, what does that look like? Almost everyone, when you walk in the front door, has a framed certificate of their accreditation. So the question that you really want to ask yourself is, oh, is this all you need to know? And the reason I mention this is because there are some laboratories who will tell you, by presenting the certificate, will say, yeah, that shows that we have the competence and we've been audited. Now let's talk about how we can save you money. What you really want to know is, what did they get audited for? So the way that accreditation works is, during that audit, right up front, the lab tells the auditor, here are the parameters that we want to be audited against. And then for each one of those, that auditor is going to spend time with the technicians and make sure that whatever that measurement discipline is, that the technicians know to do all the appropriate things. If it's RF and microwave, do they use torque wrenches or whatever it might be? If it's gauge blocks, how careful are they about temperature? Then they audit the measurement uncertainty documentation that the lab has for their calibration measurement capability. So calibration measurement capability, or CMC, is in fact the list of the best measurements and the measurement uncertainty associated with that that particular lab can make. And finally, they audit the traceability paths that we looked at in Module 3. This is probably a convenient point for me to mention that all Agilent calibrations, whether they're performed by an on-site lab or one of our regional labs, all the measurements we make are performed within the scope of accreditation for those relevant parameters. This is not required in any standard. However, we feel, as the premier measurement company, this is what we would expect if we were the customer, and we think this is what you have every right to expect when you send your instruments for calibration. So it's just something that we do. Now, I want to show you, this is an actual comparison of scopes of accreditation for several labs. So the master hub in the Americas is in Roseville, California, and I also have a second column here from our Bethlehem lab, which is just outside of Philadelphia. There's a third one there that's in the same proximity to the Bethlehem one, and I want you to look a little bit at the table. So you'll notice there's check marks in the first two columns on the Agilent labs for many of these capabilities, and yet in many cases there's no check mark over on the right hand side. What's the significance? Well, I want to respond to that. Any category that doesn't have a check mark means that the auditor did not check any of the things that we just mentioned on the last slide for any of those parameters. And shortly, I'm going to show you why that could be significant to your company. Now I want to show you why I make that claim that it's very important. Let's look at two measurements here. These are calibration lab A, calibration B. And what we see here is that there are two different measurement uncertainties associated with that. We showed this a little bit earlier, but again, it really comes into play here. Remember that the 95% expanded uncertainty is quite a bit smaller That's the interval over which the true measurement could be. Just to remind you that the true measurement in B could be largely outside of the upper specification, and even there's a region outside of the lower specification. If you're getting a calibration from a lab which is doing non-accredited parameters, the truth is you have no idea how large that red bar is. Now, I want to take a moment to just bring this home to you and show you how important this is. Let's consider a signal generator. Most signal generators are used either near their largest output or down very small. I'll give you three quick examples. A cell phone handset. When you drop a call, it could be because you're beyond the sensitivity of your cell phone. This is something which we all know is irritating. It's happened to all of us. But what if that device that we're talking about wasn't the handset, but it was the base station that's 300 feet off the ground in a repeater? Obviously, it's critical for a base station to have proper sensitivity. And sensitivity is that minimum signal, usually around a microvolt or so, which is minus 107 dBm, a very small signal. Or even more critical, suppose this was an electronic warfare receiver on an aircraft. If you don't meet the sensitivity, it's possible that that person doesn't come home. So we can't afford that. And you say, Bob, does this really happen? You're just scaring us. Let me make this real for you. I was just in the Bethlehem lab, and I saw three digital brand new spectrum analyzers that when you look at any of our microwave receivers over on A, when you go down to minus 100 dB on our new spectrum analyzers, you're off by less than 0.06 dB. It's amazing. But if you were to use any of our 1980s or 1990s spectrum analyzers that don't have digital IFs, you would not only be like, be here, it would actually be wider than that. So it matters. And in my experience, oftentimes when a lab offers calibration where they're not accredited, they're using older instruments, and you should know that there is no auditor out there that's going to allow large uncertainties like that. You just wouldn't pass the audit. That's another way that you have assurance that we're using instruments that have the proper uncertainty and accuracy to go with that. We feel that a scope of accreditation is really important, and that's why all of our service locations are accredited, and around the world, we actually use 15 different accreditation bodies, and it's very easy to go on the Agilent website and check what exactly is the scope of accreditation of any of our labs. We're very proud of that. We think that you should take a look whenever you're comparing two laboratories. What parameters for the ones I care about, are they accredited? Now, sometimes I get asked, so Bob, are there specific requirements when you want to have the accreditation body on a calibration certificate? And there are. In the Americas, you have to provide the measurement uncertainty. This is according to ILAC P14. And also, all of the measurements have to be within the scope, or if they're not, you have to report it. In the other regions around the world, Europe, Japan, and the Far East, those first two conditions are the same. And then most accreditation bodies there also ask you to do your pass-fail reporting according to ILAC G8. And as you saw earlier, we have specific services targeted that so that if that's what you need, that's what you can get. Here's an example of one of our certificates. This is from the Americas. It has the A-class accreditation body symbol. And in this particular case, the certificate says that you comply both with 17025 and with Z540.3. Now I'd like to move to the closing points. Whenever you consider two laboratories, please, please review the scope of accreditation for the individual Cal suppliers. It's very important. Secondly, we at Agilent feel it's so important that all the measurements we make are always within our scope of accreditation. And then finally, just want to remind you that whether or not you request the specific deliverables that allow us to include the accreditation body symbol, at Agilent, we will always use the same automated test procedure, the same test equipment, with the same associated measurement uncertainty. So you'll always know that we're making accurate measurements regardless of which of our services you select. So that's it on our accreditation topic. I hope this has been useful for you. Thank you.